I want you to imagine thousands of hectares of degraded, contaminated land, holes several kilometres long, across rural Australia. These are the scars of Australia's long mining history. As the mining construction boom fizzles out, what happens to the sites left behind? It's a somewhat murky picture. A new report from the Australia Institute estimates there are close to 60,000 abandoned mines across the country. Some of those date back to the gold rush days. But the report warns mine abandonment is a common phenomenon, citing recent examples in Queensland, Victoria and WA. State government agencies could only name one mine that has been fully rehabilitated, closed and relinquished in the last 10 years. Australian governments have set aside $10 billion in bonds as insurance in case companies abandon their sites, but there are concerns it's not enough. Lateline's Ginny Stein and cameraman Ron Foley travelled to the New South Wales town of Muswellbrook, home to the state's largest open-cut coal mine, and where two very different approaches to site rehabilitation are underway.
Every 8 minutes, day and night, a coal train moves through Muswellbrook. The onboard haul of a fully laden train is worth more than $1 million.
Muswellbrook, the only town of its size to be completely ringed by coal mining activity on all sides except for the railroad and river.
Muswellbrook used to be a predominantly agricultural town. Now the main business is coal.
We've got the two power stations, Liddell and Bayswater, Drayton, Mount Arthur and Bengalla, and ultimately Mount Pleasant, which will move into operation sort of mid this year as well.
The state's largest open-cut coal mine, Mount Arthur, began producing coal in the 60s. Its active mining footprint now extends to more than 1,066 hectares.
It's a very large operation, employs well over 1,000 people and would produce a significant part of the state's coal royalties.
The New South Wales government, which once owned Mount Arthur, is responsible for granting mining approvals and laying down conditions for how land should be returned.
Every mine has to look at the end of life of the mine, and there are regulations, there are stipulations as to how that land will be left.
If you look at the phases, how has it changed over the decades?
Well, prior to the late 80s, there was virtual no regulation as to how the mined land had to be left. And then more and more stipulations, so we had the requirement to rebuild those endangered ecological communities, the requirement to put it back as it was. And now we're moving into another phase, which I think is exciting because it is the phase of, well, can we add value to that land? Can we increase the number of jobs with that land if we use it differently?
Currently, less than one-third of the Mount Arthur mine site is under rehabilitation.
Originally it had four pits, it's now down to three, but it does leave the largest pit in the valley presently under its present approvals. So a lot of work needs to be done by the state government, the industry, particularly Mount Arthur, of course, and the council, to really try and get the size of that final landform void down.
Concern about the slow rate of rehabilitation resulted in the state imposing new consent provisions for the mine. BHP is now required to rehabilitate land disturbed by mining as soon as possible.
A mine rehab like this today wouldn't be acceptable.
The mine is also required to shape its manufactured hills in a way that more closely resembles what was here before. BHP declined our request to visit Mount Arthur, but it did provide these photos to demonstrate its rehabilitation efforts. They show the land's progress over 15 years. The regrowth areas remain sparse and the hilltop flat. New mining is taking place in front of it.
It doesn't look particularly natural, it just looks like a big bread loaf. No longer best practice. But what happens on these older type mines is the drainage comes straight down the hill that you can see behind us and goes into horizontal drainage lines and then collects into a single drop structure and then goes down the balance of the hill. Obviously you wouldn't see that in nature. Best practice is really what's occurring at Mangoola. The challenge for the government is transitioning between the two.
Mining giant Glencore started production at Mangoola, to the west of Musselbrook, in 2011. The company invited Lateline to film its rehabilitation efforts, which it believes exceed state government requirements.
Once that first seam is uncovered, we will remove that and then continue mining waste material until we uncover the next seam of coal.
Here, rehabilitation planning begins before the first shovel of coal is dug up.
So what we're looking at here, Ginny, this is a pit that we've mined out now. We've taken out the coal that we've planned, and we're in the process of filling it in now with waste overburden.
The company plans to relinquish this site once mining is done, something only one mine in New South Wales has achieved.
What we hope to do is to try and relinquish land progressively, not just wait till the end of the mine life. So with some of our more mature areas, we'll be looking at trying to relinquish that early. And that's the aim.
You'd be a rare mine to relinquish, wouldn't you, in New South Wales?
Well, look, it does happen. It depends on the size of the operation. We saw an opportunity here to do something different. We're quite blessed here because we're a fairly shallow mine. So our dump profile is fairly low. So it enabled us to do a little bit more with contouring and developing natural landform at quite a palatable cost.
So what we're walking through here is our oldest rehab. So this was established in late 2011. Most people are really surprised that 5 or 6 years ago, the area that we're standing in now was just a big hole in the ground. It was a 30 to 40 metre deep open cut coal mine. And now you're surrounded by trees that are 6 to 8 metres tall.
Bird boxes and tree trunks with hollows have been installed and natural water flows created.
It's going to take sort of 100 years maybe for natural hollows to develop, so we need to fill that void at the moment for habitat that's being lost, for that crucial nesting habitat.
I do all the bulk shape, which is the bulk shape is I leave the final landfall before the topsoil comes onto it. Sometimes you'll get a design and what was he thinking when he gave me this, you know, the little hollows and stuff. But then you look back at the whole, once you've done 50 hectares, and it's like a natural farm. Rolling hills, gullies, it's all natural.
You've been in the earth moving business a long time.
Yes.
Your job's generally to make things flat.
Yes, and in mining, the general idea in mining is generally to get the dirt off as quickly as you can, and it has been where I've worked, in other companies I've worked, just get rid of the dirt, and then they deal with the dirt at the end. Here, they put the dirt where it's needed, in the final position, ready to push.
While much will be filled in, there will still be a 55 hectare hole left behind when mining is done here.
There are reasons, of course, to leave some very small voids in to manage water quality and particularly the hunter's catchment. But we know that voids can be filled in. There have been mine proposals, new mine proposals, which propose to fill in the voids from the very get-go. So it can be done, it should be done, and increasingly the community will expect it be done.
Last week, a Senate inquiry was announced into mining rehabilitation following a motion put forward by the Greens and supported by Labor. It will investigate how Australia is repairing mine sites and consider the environmental consequences. For more, I spoke earlier to Greens leader Richard Di Natale from Canberra. Richard Di Natale, thanks for your time. Why do we need this parliamentary inquiry into mining rehabilitation?
Because we've got thousands of mines around this country that need to be rehabilitated. We've got existing mines that where companies have left insufficient bonds. So what will happen is those companies will walk away, they'll leave a toxic legacy, and the taxpayer will need to foot the bill for repairing those mines. So it is absolutely critical that we ensure that we've got a full audit, we've got national standards for how these mines should be rehabilitated, and that the companies who make the mess clean it up when they're finished.
$10 billion in environmental bonds has been set aside by various governments to deal with the scenario arising of mines not rehabilitating or companies not rehabilitating their mines properly. Is that not enough? It seems like a lot of money.
It seems like a lot of money, but there are a hell of a lot of mines out there and the cost of rehabilitation is significant. So part of the permit to get a mine off the ground is that you commit to making sure that you rehabilitate that mine when you're finished. What happens is the bonds are often inadequate. When they do the rehabilitation, it's not done to an appropriate standard. And then, of course, you've got some companies who set themselves up in a way that they've got other shell companies. They end up going bankrupt when the life of the mine's finished and they leave it up to the taxpayer to clean it up.
One of the things we discovered is it's quite hard to nail down exactly which mines are in operation and which mines are not. How would you imagine addressing that?
Well, that's why we need the inquiry. We need to have a comprehensive review of all mines, both in operation, and we need to look at the historical evidence of those mines that have been used but not rehabilitated. We should set up a national commissioner to make sure that we get to the bottom of what's required to be done. And in the end, it's the taxpayer who ends up footing the bill if this isn't done properly. It amounts to a massive subsidy to the mining industry. Many of these coal mines end up relying on the taxpayer to basically subsidise their operations. And we don't think that's fair.